You are listening to Daily Bread Devotions with Father Eustace Yame, a Salesian of Don Bosco. Your word, Lord, is a lamp for my steps. Stay tuned.
This is my daily bread. This is my daily bread. Your very word, spoken to me.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
It is Thursday, the 4th of August, 2022, 18th week in ordinary time. And today we keep the memorial of John Maria Vianney, patron of parish priests. Born on May 8th, 1786 in France, a place I had the privilege of visiting, and died on August 4th, 1859, at the age of 73. Jean-Baptiste Marie Vianney, known as Saint John Vianney, was a French parish priest. He is often referred to as the cure of Ars. Although his talents were limited and his education low, he was ordained a priest in 1815. After 3 years at Écully, he was appointed parish priest of Ars, where he spent almost 42 years of his life, devoting himself to prayer, mortification, and pastoral works. His success in directing souls made him known throughout the Christian world. Men of all ranks and conditions of life sought his guidance and advice. Participating in the proclamation of the Word of God for today are the following Daily Bread members: Robin Kofu from Chitungwiza, Zimbabwe, who celebrates his birthday today, takes for us the first reading. Echi Helen from Kumba, Cameroon, takes for us the responsorial psalm. And proclaiming the gospel is Father Andrew Chapewa Mwila from Ndola Diocese, as he celebrates his priestly anniversary today. Let us pray. Almighty and merciful God, who made the priest St. John Vianney wonderful in his pastoral zeal, grant, we pray, that through his intercession and example, we may in charity win brothers and sisters for Christ and attain with them eternal glory. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God, forever and ever. Amen.
First reading. I'll make a new covenant. I'll remember their sin no more. A reading from the book of Jeremiah. Jeremiah 31, verses 31 to 34. Behold, the days are coming, says the Lord, when I'll make a new covenant with the house of Israel and the house of Judah, not like the covenant which I made with their fathers when I took them by the hand to bring them out of the land of Egypt, my covenant which they broke, and I showed myself their master, says the Lord. But this is the covenant which I will make with the house of Israel after those days, says the Lord. I'll put my law within them, and I will write it upon their hearts, and I will be their God, and they shall be my people. And no longer shall each man teach his neighbor, and each his brother, saying, Know the Lord, for they shall all know me, from the least of them to the greatest, says the Lord. For I will forgive their iniquity, and I will remember their sin no more. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Responsorial Psalm, Psalm 51, verse 12 to 13, 14 to 15, 18 to 19. And the response is taken from Psalm 51, verse 12a. And the response is,
Create a pure heart for me, O God.
Create a pure heart for me, O God. Renew a steadfast spirit within me. Do not cast me away from your presence. Take not your Holy Spirit from me.
Create a pure heart for me, O God.
Restore in me the joy of your salvation. Sustain in me a willing spirit. I will teach transgressors your ways, that sinners may return to you.
Create a pure heart for me, O God.
For in sacrifice you take no delight. Burnt offering from you would not please you. My sacrifice to God, a broken spirit, a broken and humble heart, O God, you will not spurn.
Create a pure heart for me, O God.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Matthew.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Matthew chapter 16, verse from 13 to verse 23. At that time, when Jesus came into the district of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, "Who do men say that the Son of Man is?" And they said, "Some say John the Baptist, others say Elijah, and others Jeremiah or one of the prophets." He said to them, "But who do you say that I am?" Simon Peter replied, "You are the Christ, the Son of the living God." And Jesus answered him, "Blessed are you, Simon Bar-Jonah, for flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, but my Father who is in heaven. And I tell you, you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of Hades shall not prevail against it. I will give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven, and whatever you bind on earth shall be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven." Then he strictly charged the disciples to tell no one that he was the Christ. From that time, Jesus began to show his disciples that he must go to Jerusalem and suffer many things from the elders and the chief priests and the scribes, and be killed, and on the third day be raised. And Peter took him and began to rebuke him, saying, "God forbid, Lord, this shall never happen to you." But he turned and said to Peter, "Get behind me, Satan. You are a hindrance to me, for you are not on the side of God, but of men." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
We continue drawing some strength from the Book of Consolation. That part in Jeremiah that is very consoling and fulfilling. He's now promising something to the people. God is going to do a new thing. The people of Israel had been given a law on Mount Sinai by Moses when they were coming out of Egypt. And that law, they promised they were going to follow. But because it was something written, something on paper, these people, after the death of Moses, even when Moses was still there, did not live according to that law. They went their own way. They decided to follow their own gods. It happens very often where we see in our parishes, in our Christian communities, people going to witch doctors even after the strong preaching of their priests. Even after the strong messages given to them, they choose to go their way. Because anyway, the priest is not there to see. Because anyway, nobody is seeing them. Why? Because their worship is external. It is far away from them. Now God decided to do a new thing. I'm going to make my law be written on their hearts. No longer will be religion. No longer will religion be a thing on paper, a following of rubrics, a following of rituals, but it will be a sincere worship from the heart. People are going to walk as if they are seeing him who is invisible. People are going to do things knowing there is only one who sees them, God. And so they will do things right even when they are away from the church. They are going to do things right in those offices where nobody is seeing them. They are going to do things right at the marketplace where nobody doesn't know where they worship. But God alone, a religion of the heart, is what God is advocating for. And he is praying that that takes place the soonest. We want superficiality to end. We want mediocrity to end. We are not following a God of impression. We are not here to just impress people. No, we want a genuine worship. That worship that Jesus wanted to be fulfilled when he spoke to that woman by the well in John chapter 4 verse 23. The hour is coming, and it has already come, when true worshipers shall worship the Father in spirit and in truth. He was saying this as a fulfillment of the prophecy of Jeremiah. When people are going to have the law of the Lord written on their hearts, they are going to worship God in spirit and in truth, and no one will teach another, this is the way. No, people are going to know the right path, and they will live according to that right path. Jesus has this similar concern as he walks with his disciples towards Caesarea Philippi. A lot of things have happened, and people have gotten their own impression about Jesus Christ. And sometimes people may come to church, get a lot of things, understand a lot of things about Christ, but they understand those things in a group. They have no personal conviction. They will say, this is what we believe in our church. Yeah, we Catholics believe in this. But what is your faith yourself? Tell me your concrete faith. Tell me who Jesus is in your life. You, yourself, not any other. Who do people say that I am? Oh, some say John the Baptist, Herod. Others say Elijah, and others Jeremiah, or one of the prophets. The Jeremiah we are just talking about. But he is concerned about the personalization of faith. Is concerned about how his interaction with them has helped them to grow in their own faith. But you, who do you say that I am? It is Simon Peter who spoke up and said, you are the Christ, the Son of the living God. You see, I like this expression found only in Matthew. You are the Christ, the Son of the living God. Meaning you are coming from a God that is alive, not like the dead gods that others worship. No, you are coming from the real existent God. That's the faith we have. And that's the faith I have. I've experienced this. I've seen you walk on water. I've seen you feed thousands. You are the Son of the living God. Oh, Simon, it's not fresh and... Oh, Simon Bar-Jonah, look at this. That profession of faith makes Jesus even to mention his dad. Simon Bar-Jonah, like saying Eustace Bar-Siame, Eustace son of Siame. Meaning my father becomes honored because of my faith. Peter's dad, Jonah, is honored because of his faith. Have your faith strong. Strengthen your faith. Strengthen your conviction in God, and your parents are going to be honored through you. Simon, son of John. Simon Bar-Jonah. It is not flesh and blood that has revealed to you this, but my father. And you know what? Because of this faith, not because of your human ambitions, because I know you, Peter, very soon you are going to say something else because you don't understand even what you have said. This is the revelation coming from God. I will show you that you don't understand what you have said, because when I talk about my death and suffering, you are going to say this should not happen to you. And I will tell you, get behind me, Satan. because your human self has come out. But at this moment, the revelation has come from God. Jesus wants to say, Peter and many others who are going to take his place, who are going to work for me, are human beings. And human as they may be, they are inspired by God to say what they say. But they have their own human ambitions. So it's the same with all our priests. As we remember John Marie Vianney, the patron of parish priests, the patron of all those who are doing the work of God. We know that they, these priests who are doing the work of God, are human beings and they make mistakes. And human as they are, they should be listened to. They are divine. They say a lot of inspirations that should help us in our own lives to grow. We give glory to the Father and to the Son and to the Holy Spirit.
As it was in the beginning, is now and ever shall be, world without end. Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
And may Almighty God bless you, the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Blessed Thursday to you and happy feast of John Marie Vianney.
Thanks be to God.
This is my daily bread. Your very word spoken to me. And I your best.